I'm Dr. John Cooper Clarke and
Hugh Cornwell.
And we're going to itemise the indispensable qualities inherent in each individual track on this album. This time it's personal. It's Only Make Believe, written by Conway Twitty and Jack Nance, performed by Conway Twitty. This was an adventurous choice, H, requiring, as it does, a vocal range from way down there to way up. If I could make a convincing version of this, then anything after this would be a doddle.
Was that
the thinking there?
But it's a grower. I mean, it starts very simple, doesn't it? And then it sort of grows into a sort of crescendo.
Builds up into this opera of heartbreak.
Yeah, opera of heartbreak. I like that.
And yet it maintains a kind of intimacy at the same time.
Yeah.
It's a great song. Way down yonder in New Orleans, in the land of those dreams. Track 2, written by J.T. Layton Jr. and lyrics by Henry Creamer. Way Down Yonder in New Orleans, the Freddie Cannon.
I think it's an old show tune, written in the 20s or something.
Really, yeah, because it's got that sort of fashionable jazz New Orleans reference
point. I first heard the Freddie Cannon version when it was canonised.
But it sounded kind of like it wasn't a rock and roll song then.
No.
You know, it sounded like it had come from, you know, New Orleans. Louisiana. There is a rose
in Spanish Harlem. Next on the list was Spanish Harlem, which was, Phil Spector play on an acoustic guitar, a very rare recording, because he wrote it with Lieber, from Lieber and Stoller. Very touching hearing him play it on an acoustic guitar. I mean, it's a lovely song. I mean, what a great, and of course the version I heard was was it the Drifters?
No, I don't think it was the Drifters. I think it was Benny King after
he
split.
King, that's right.
After he'd split with the Drifters, it was one of his first solo records. And.
What a kickoff.
It was covered over here at the time in England by a guy called Jimmy Justice.
Oh yeah.
In those days, you know, they used to kind of have a race to the top of the hit parade.
The American version and the UK
and
version.
Very often the American version was delayed.
Yes.
In order, because they were always superior.
Yeah.
Let's face it, you know.
Next song, Johnny Remember Me, written by Jeff Goddard. And in fact, sang by John Layton. I saw John Layton in a film the other night called Guns at Batazi with Richard Attenborough.
Yeah, I remember
and
that one. Yeah.
He's a good actor.
Oh, yeah, he was an actor first.
With Mia Farrow in her first film. And of course, produced by Joe Meek.
Produced backed by the Outlaws. And if there's a piano on there, I'm not sure whether there is. I wouldn't mind putting a nice piece of 20-1 on that being Chas Hodges.
Really?
Well, he worked with the Outlaws, didn't he?
Well, it's a good choice of song because, seeing as you're John Cooper Clarke, I thought Johnny Remember Me.
Absolutely, it's got my name written all over it there. MacArthur Park is melting in the dark. MacArthur Park, I suspect I was, as we mentioned before, this was the first one that I recorded for the album, isn't it? You know, I can understand why you might have had me in the frame for that, it being a sort of self-consciously poetic lyric.
Apparently it's about an affair he had with a lady who worked near Glendale Park, which became MacArthur Park, and the only place they could meet was in the park at lunchtimes. And apparently all the things that were mentioned in the song are all things that he saw when he was in the park meeting her.
I see, so kind of peripheral observations.
Yeah. She can wash 24 pairs of socks and have them hanging out on the side. B kicks off with
She's a Woman by Jerry Lieber and Mike Stoller, originally recorded by Christine Kittrell, and was a hit the same year for Peggy Lee.
Peggy Lee, that's the one I heard.
I'm a Woman, of course, in the case of those two artists. And Ray Charles covered it. She's a Woman.
Yeah, I love Peggy Lee's version.
Peggy Lee is the first one I heard.
Yeah.
Terrific, yeah.
Yeah. So next is Donna by Richie Valens. I mean, The guy, I mean, he was, how old was he when he died? 19 or something?
Yeah, 19 or something.
And his debut album that came out posthumously had 3 number ones on it.
Oh, Death Sells each, we all know that.
Ridiculous.
It's the unwritten law.
Yeah. Donna, like this song.
Sensational. It's a great movie about, a great biopic actually of him, isn't it, with Lou Diamond Phillips playing Richie.
That's right. Yeah.
And it's got all his music on that, you know, on the soundtrack. Fabulous artist, yeah. And he wrote his own stuff, didn't he?
Yeah. It's such a simple song. I mean, you couldn't get it much more simple than.
He specialised in that kind of simple approach. Come on, let's go. Remember that one?
La Bamba's pretty simple.
Yeah, La Bamba
as well,
isn't it? As well. Sensational.
Yeah.
Track number 3 on side B, written by Wayne Shanklin, hit for Frankie Lane around 1951-52, Jezebel.
Yeah, what a great song.
That's sensational. Yeah. And that's sort of pre-rock and roll, isn't it?
It is. Yeah.
But it's got all that grit in it.
Yes, and very odd chord sequences too. It's not like a blues progression or anything.
No, it's Tin Pan Alley. It's a construction, isn't it?
It's almost Eastern.
Yeah. You know that
gypsy with the gold cap too. Next on the album is Love Potion Number 9, another Lieber Stoller song. I mean, what a great partnership they were.
A fabulous Lieber and Stoller, yeah. They wrote a lot of stuff for the... In fact, I wouldn't mind betting if the Coasters didn't do this one. Am I right there, actually? Let's just leave it as a mystery. I wouldn't be surprised. They wrote a lot of stuff for the Coasters. And this is right up their street, a kind of wry humour at work.
Yeah, lyrics.
And, you know, when he kisses the cop.
Yeah, you it's almost like saying? Viagra in 1960, whenever it
yeah,
was.
Yeah, that'll be it. Love Potion Number 9 was always featured very highly in all those Merseybeat groups she used to do.
Yes, first time I heard it was The Searchers.
Yeah, The Searchers featured it heavy, yeah. They all did it. Yeah, The Searchers did it on the first album, I think.
Yeah, they did.
But a cracking number.
So if you say... So Sweeter Than You is the final track on the album, written by Baker Knight and recorded by Rick Nelson. I just love Rick Nelson's
Yeah, I love Ricky Nelson. He was kind of a great favourite of mine when I was a kid, you know. I mean, obviously I loved Elvis. But there were all those kind of mini Elvises, you know, kind of slightly decaffeinated versions of Elvis, you know, that were, you know, 16 and 17 years old. And he was the first one to moan about being a teenage idol, which I liked as well, you know, that song. We're going to try that one sometime. Remember Teenage Idol, you know, that all that. Ain't all beer and skittles, you know, how lonely he is and all that, you know, fantastic. Yeah. Really milking the victim, you know, flying the victim flag, and he's living this like a millionaire at 16, you know, with being asked to sympathise with him, you know. Obviously, this means a great deal to me because it goes out directly from my heart to my loved one. So there's a bit of me in that.